Praise the Lord. So good to have you today. Are you glad to be here at church, at Fellowship Church today? Praise the Lord. Great. As I always say, stand, sit, whatever you want to, but surely enter into worship with us as we play our music this morning and sing praises unto the Lord. Amen. takes the power from sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is a take my place, that you would take my, that you would bear my cross. You laid down that I would be set free, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I seek for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me, yeah. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. Yes, it is.
This is amazing love.
That you would take my place.
That you would take my place.
That you would bear my cross. Set free. Oh, Jesus, I seek for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. Yes, it is. You would take my place.
That you would bear my cross.
You laid down. Yes, you did. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I see all that you've done for me. Lord, aren't you glad he done something for you today? Amen. Aren't you glad of his amazing grace? Praise the Lord.
All things have passed away. Your love has stayed. Breathing in life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
When I think about the Lord,
when I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, it makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout.
Well, you sung about it. You said, now you said it. Makes me want to shout. I mean, you said it. You said it. Makes me want to shout. Anybody want to shout right now? Go ahead. Come on. Come on. Ha ha ha. Don't ever lose your shout. Glory to God. I enjoyed the song service this morning. And Peyton, you did a great job in leading those songs. Isn't she pretty? Isn't she wonderful? And I count it a privilege to have her here on the team at Fellowship Church, working as youth pastor, kids pastor, multiplicity is a thing she does. And I want to tell you, we appreciate her and her gift and her anointing and her love. Peyton saw some hard times coming up in some days, in some ways. But you know what? even as a little bitty girl. When she used to sit on my lap, I can remember even then she loved Jesus and had a call on her life. And she's fulfilling that call today. And we're glad we can be a part of it, aren't we? Amen. Amen. Well, just turn around. I know we're not practicing shaking hands again. Not yet. It will come. Say it will come. But just turn around and wave at 2 or 3, 4 or 5 folk. Smile at them now. They won't think you're mad. Did you tell everybody hello? Just in case you miss somebody, do that one more time. Wave at somebody you didn't get a chance. Hallelujah. Glory. Anyway, I'm talking to them about something. Don't pay me no mind. It's good to have all of you. You glad to be here? Anybody good? Glad to. Hey. There is Huberta and her son Jordan. Can you believe this? Oh, come on. Give God some praise. Jordan's out there praising God. I tell you, Jordan was close to dying, to death. But thank God he had a Christian mama. A Christian mama that would pray and wouldn't take no for an answer. And we'll just get her to say something at another time later on. But I'm telling you, God, Jordan, God has done so much for you. He's brought you so far. People that know anything about all the accident and everything happened, you want to say something? Come on up just suckers. Okay. That would have been good. That would have been good. That's all right. You get to speak to Michael today before you leave. Michael, you speak to Jordan today before you leave. Remember that. Well, we're going to receive our tithes and offering. I want to thank you for being here, but I want to encourage you also to come on Wednesday night. We're teaching some good stuff on Wednesday night. And I tell you what, most people, we end up staying at home and we end up watching TV and just sitting around. Could be no better place than to come to church. Let's just get into that habit of coming together. The Bible talks about coming together as one in unity. It's powerful. We're stronger together. So I want to invite you Wednesday evening. Be here every Wednesday evening. We're going to have a good time in the Lord. Are you ready to give today? Praise God. And I want to thank you for your finances. You've been so blessed to help us during this time, during this crisis, and, you know, all the things that happened. But I want to thank you for your financial support and your love. And you just keep right on giving. In fact, some of you have increased your giving because you said, I'm sowing seed during this time. Isaac sowed in the year of famine. And he got a 100-fold return in the same year he sowed in the year of famine. So when things are going on in your life and things are not going the way maybe you would like for it to go, keep sowing that seed. And I believe you're going to get a turnaround in your life just like Isaac did. Amen. Are you ready to give? Thank you for your tithes and offering today.
When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me. So everybody sing it. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, it makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. makes me want to shout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Sing it again. It makes me want to shout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor. Oh, yeah. Makes me want to shout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shine.
Didn't find a file. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Had a lot to get there. Right now, we're going to have a little special music. So, if you would, come on up. Look, this is Gloria Austin, if you don't know her. And for some reason, I want to call her Valerie still. I don't know why. I said, Valerie, Gloria. So I said, let me make sure I call you the right name. Okay.
Thank you, Jesus.
So Miss Gloria, though, has been with us since the beginning of the year. And at about the time that she was about to join is when COVID-19 hit. And so that kind of put it a little down the road. And she eventually joined with us about 2 months ago, and she came to my office, and we were going to sing, and then she had a little bit of setback with some things in her health. But she has recovered. She's doing very well. Hallelujah. Praise be to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
So this is mainly her song. I just kind of join in a little bit, okay?
And that's all right. Thank you, Lord. I'm ready.
In your time of trouble, just reach out and say the name, that sweet name of Jesus. Say the name of Jesus. Say the name of Jesus. Say the name so precious. No other name the name of Jesus. Say the name of Jesus. Say the name so precious. No other name I know that can calm your fears and dry you can't find the words to say. Just say the name.
Oh, yeah.
Say the name.
Say the name.
Say the name,
Jesus. to pray
when you can't find the words to say.
Say the name.
Oh, heaven, say the name of Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. Jesus.
Jesus.
Sweetest name I know.
Jesus.
Sweeter than honey in the honeycomb. Jesus.
Jesus.
We need to call on the name of Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, yes. Call his name Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. My lover of my soul.
Jesus.
Do is say the name. Just say the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory.
Praise the Lord. His name is what? Jesus. Amen. Nothing like good Sprite here. Oh, Lord. Can't believe this. I have done messed up this. Sure, I guess, Melanie, you've got a stain that you've got to take care of. And looking at this stain makes me think about today's topic, negativity. It'll mess more than your clothes up, it'll mess your life up. The stain of negativity will ruin a business. That was on purpose, brother, I don't need it. It will ruin a marriage. Don't mess me up. No. It will ruin a marriage, a business, a team, a company, even a church. But there's something about people that like to air their dirty laundry, isn't it? We like to sort it, go through it, hang it up, and celebrate it. Do you ever work with someone that sees life half empty? Do you work with someone that likes to air their dirty laundry? You may be your next door neighbor. Careful to say this. Married to someone like, no, excuse me. I shouldn't have said that shit. Don't say it if you think it. No, I'm just kidding. If you answer to yes to any of these questions, Today's topic is for you, though, and for me. It's for all of us, because everybody has been or is guilty of being negative, and we need to change that. Amen. So today we're going to talk about how do we get through all this negativity? How do we get clean? How do we get that spot off? When I say negativity, what comes to your mind? Negativity has a lot of words and associations. Slander, secrets, sarcasm, cynicism, pessimism. Sounds like a bunch of snakes, doesn't it? Well, that's what negativity is. It comes from the snake, from the devil, from the enemy, and it's going to destroy you if you don't get rid of it, or at least learn how to navigate around others who are. People love negativity, seems like. Negative news, negative people, and so forth. And the media, they sure love to be negative. But before we jump on them today, let's look at ourselves. They are partially that way because we love negative news, right? You see, I remember one time this guy came to my house, and he was a master at what he did. He was extremely good, very talented, but it was not electricity that he was talented at. He was good at another trade. But I don't know about you, but I know some tradesmen, and not all are like that, but some, if they're real good at one thing, they think they can do another one too. Well, that's where this guy was. So we were having an electricity problem. See, he said, I know a little bit about electricity. And that was the key word, little bit. So he cut the wrong wire, and he said, oh my gosh, I felt a jolt. And I'm telling you, that jolt won't the Holy Ghost either. He could have died because of playing with something that he did not fully understand. He got his wires crossed, so to speak. That is what we do, don't we? When we play with negativity, we get our wires crossed. We look at everything with a negative viewpoint, everything with fault, and instead of through the loving eyes of Jesus Christ. Life is too short to get our wires crossed. We need to stop negativity. You fool around with it, and you're going to feel a jolt to your life too. And it might not literally kill you, but it sure will put you in a bad spot. You know, we have to maintain a positive, faith-filled attitude even when negative things or negative people are around us. See, people don't really understand the impact negativity can have on them. It might fry them, burn them, and destroy them. It'll destroy relationships, family, friendships, business, church, etc. It will do it. Now, how many of you like, I'm not saying you like all the words to it, but I mean the sound. You like Southern country music. You like a little country music. You like the sound of country music. That's okay. Raise your hand. Don't, you know, you can be prideful, say, I like country, you know. Well, I like the sound of some of the songs, but some of the songs can be very depressing, you know. This old Randy Travis song. I'll give you an example. I told you so. Oh, I told you so. I told you someday you'd come crawling back and asking me to take you hand. I told you so, but you had to go. Now I found somebody new and you would never break my heart in two again. That's not uplifting, is it? It's pretty sad. Or another song, I've got friends in low places. I can't even get that low. Low places. Nothing against country music enthusiasts. But I think that's kind of where some people are in the realm of their mind with everything. They've got this country music mentality. See, we're naturally kind of like those songs, though, aren't we?
We have this dirty laundry mentality. The Bible says a lot about negativity. And it gives us examples, though, of how to come clean. Life is too short to be negative. What do you think? How long do we live? The average lifespan of Americans keeps going up. Thank God for good medicine. Thank God for people going to church and learning how to walk in health and be victorious. Amen. I'm telling you, the United States, if it wasn't for car accidents, because we have so many people and we're so blessed to have cars, that's what even skews the numbers more. If it wasn't for that, our lifespan would be bigger than any country in the world. And it's pretty close to it anyway, even with that. So we're blessed to be here in this healthcare system. Amen. How long do we live? The average life expectancy for ladies now is 84 years old. And for men, 79. I think that's something we can be positive about today. There's so much negative. I think that's a good positive thing. How about you? Living longer. The average person has 8 to 8.5 decades to live. So I say life is way too short to destroy and to live miserable in those decades with being negative. When I think about negativity in the Bible, I think about the children of Israel. They could have gotten their doctorate and postdoctorate degrees in negativity if there would have been such a thing. They were miraculously delivered from Egyptian slavery. You'd think they'd be happy. God guided them with a wonderful GPS system consisting of a cloud by day and a fire by night. And he gave them a wonderful piece of real estate called the Promised Land. The Bible says that right before they entered the Promised Land, though, that God told Moses to choose 12 spies to spy out the land. Amen. If you would today, and you have your Bibles, turn with me to Numbers chapter 13. Numbers chapter 13. Now, I don't know what your translation is, but everything that I'm reading today, I'm reading from the New Living Translation, the NLT. If you like other translations, hallelujah. It's the Word of God. I just particularly like this one myself. So, Numbers 13. The Lord now said to Moses, "Send out men to explore the land of Canaan, the land I am giving to the Israelites." Go down to verse 17, if you would. Moses gave the men these instructions as he sent them out to explore the land. "Go north through the Negev into the hill country. See what the land is like and find out whether the people living there are strong or weak, few or many. See what kind of land they live in. Is it good or bad? Do their towns have walls, or are they unprotected like open camps? Is the soil fertile or poor? Are there many trees? Do your best to bring back samples of the crops you see." So, turn to verse 25. After exploring the land for 40 days, the men returned to Moses, Aaron, and the whole community of Israel at Kadesh in the wilderness of Paran. They reported to the whole community that what they had seen and showed them the fruit that they had taken from the land. Go on to 27. This was the report to Moses. "We entered the land you sent to us to explore, and it is indeed a beautiful country, a land flowing with milk and honey. Here is the kind of fruit it produces." Oh my gosh, you would have think they'd have been happy after that. "It is indeed a wonderful land full of fruits and pomegranates and figs and all these great things." But they didn't see it that way. Not so fast, they said. "But the people living there are powerful, and their towns are large and fortified. We even saw giants there, the descendants of Anak. The Amalekites live in the Negev, and the Hittites, Jebusites, and Amorites live in the hill country. The Canaanites live along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea and along the Jordan Valley. You see, there were 3 million people, some historians say, that were deserted for 40 years because 12 spies were sent out and 10 of them brought a negative report. Only 10, it took just 10 people to hurt and destroy and to kill 3 million other people's faith and stop them from going to the promised land. So if you dwell on it, it doesn't take a lot of negative to hurt a whole lot of people, right? It runs in packs at the office, at your team, wherever you go. It can't happen, because if it starts to get and rise and get bigger, it causes problems. See, those 10 spies, they said that the people were large, but they should have kept that to themselves. They shouldn't have spread it, even if they thought. Why do we have this tendency toward negativity as people sometimes? Well, sometimes it's frankly because we don't want to take a risk. We kind of want to be the status quo. We don't want to step up, so we just have an excuse for not doing it. We say, well, it's too hard. No, it's not too, it's going to be hard, but you can do it in the name of Jesus. Don't be negative. If God called you to do it, you can do it. Another reason is fearful. We're fearful. The unknown. The people are too large. This task is too big. There's no way I could ever have the talent to do that. But if you could see what was on the other side of the mountain, you might just fight a little harder. Amen? We should not cower in fear or be lazy and don't want to take risk. Amen? If God called you to do it, it's never going to be easy, but He will provide you with the ability. He will provide you with the courage. He will provide you with the know-how and all the supplies you need to finish the job, so to speak. Let's go on down to verse 30. But, I like this, but Caleb tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses. Let's go at once to take the land, he said. We can certainly conquer it. Wow, that changed the atmosphere, didn't it? We can certainly conquer it, he said. But, there goes Bud on the other side again. But the other men who had explored the land with him disagreed. We can't go up against them. They are stronger than we are. So they spread this bad report about the land among the Israelites. The land we traveled through and explored would devour anyone who goes to live there. All the people we saw were huge. We even saw giants there, the descendants of Anak. Next to them, we felt like grasshoppers, and that's what they thought too. Wow. You see, a lot of negativity. Let's go over to 14, the next chapter, verse 6. It says, two of the men who explored the land, Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, tore their clothing. They said to all the people, the land we traveled through and explored is a wonderful land, and if the Lord is pleased with us, He will bring us safely into that land and give it to us. It is a land rich, flowing with milk, and honey. Do not rebel against the Lord, and don't be afraid of the people of the land. They are only helpless prey to us. They have no protection, but the Lord is with us. Don't be afraid of them, they said. They, Joshua and Caleb, had a great report. They were the only two that got through it. Why? Because of their faith. They doubted not. See, it doesn't matter what the naysayers say. I don't care if it's you and your wife, if it's you and one other person or yourself. If you stay strong and you do what the Lord calls you to do, don't give up. Don't cower down. Don't get in fear. Don't say it's too hard. Don't say it's too they're too big. This is too much. No, all things are possible to those who believe in Christ Jesus. He says in Philippians, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. See, there was a lot of going on. An example, in verse 31 through 33, it was an example of people taking, the spies taking the people's hope away. It eventually took their faith away. You know, there are many horrible diseases and plagues throughout history. Cancer, heart disease, the bubonic plague, 1918 Spanish flu, and even now, the epidemic we have called COVID-19. But they all pale in comparison to the most highly infectious disease of them all, negativity. It can destroy any organization, any family. But you know, I've come today and the Lord put this in my heart. I wasn't planning to say it, but you know what? I got to thinking about what's going on now. And I want to give you some things, and I want to tell you my reasoning behind what I'm saying. I respect everybody's decision. I love everybody, and I want them to do and be safe through this time. I want them to do what's best for them. I think we've said that over and over at our church. I think you see that if you come in here, we've got tape. We even made a video, kind of a funny video, rap video about it. Don't sit on the tape. We've kept social distancing. We encourage people, if you want to wear a mask, fine. I think it's great. I want you to be comfortable, and I want you to come here. And if you don't, that's fine. You can stay at home, and you still hear us through Facebook. That's wonderful, too. I want you to get the Word of God. But so I'm not in any way, what I'm going to say, saying against anybody. I'm not knocking any group, any individuals. I respect everybody. And I'm not being political, so get that right now, please. I am not being political. But here's the deal. I want to give you some good news. Well, let me give you not good news first, but I'm going to turn it around. And look, it's the way you look at things. I believe this, the Lord put it in my heart. I said, I want to see what the statistics are. 328 million people live in the United States. 183,000 have died of COVID-19. Now that's one death is too many on any disease, right? I want life. God wants life. But we know who the enemy is behind this. But if we look at it statistically, 0.0056 is the percentage of people dying. That's 56 out of every 10,000 people. Now, that's not good, but it's not as many would make you want to think it is on TV if you look at this thing. North Carolina, 2,708 deaths. One is too many. 0.00027 out of our 10.49 million people, the percentage out of 10.49 million people is 0.00027, which is 27 out of every 100,000. Like I said, one death is too many. But instead of celebrating, and it's all time, this is, they died, and I understand that. But I'm glad that it's real minuscule compared to our population. I think that our president, I think our governor, I think they've all done a good job. I'm not taking any sides. I'm glad, I don't want one single death, but I'm going to look at this thing in a positive way, that thank God it could have been a lot worse. It could have been worse. And we as a Christian have Psalm 91. We can rely on. Amen. Hallelujah. Psalm 91 says, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I will trust in Him. For He will rescue you from every trap and protect you from deadly disease. Hallelujah! Goes on to say in verse 5, do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrow that flies in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Hallelujah! I've come to say the devil has put a lot of bad things on a lot of people, caused a lot of havoc. He's behind all bad, and it's even one death is bad for any disease. But in comparison to the number of people we have, if you listen to it on TV, oh, it's just so bad. It's all the time. And that's just simply, you think for yourself. See, negativity, though, starts with you and me. What do we do with it? 3 million people were destroyed by 10 people bringing a bad report. And let me tell you something, when people start bringing bad reports, they every time exaggerate it. Have you ever known somebody and they told you about a situation and you think, my goodness, this is awful, and you come to find out the truth has so been distorted, it's not even close to how bad it is. But even if it was, God can bring us out. We're Christian people. We have a covenant with our God, don't we? Do we or not have one? Why, my company can't grow like that. That can't be done. Well, if you keep saying it, it won't. Amen. Look it down at Numbers where we were. Go back to Numbers and 14th chapter and the second verse. It says, their voices rose in a great chorus of protest against Moses and Aaron. If only we had died in Egypt or even here in the wilderness, they complained. Why is the Lord taking us to this country only to have us die in battle? Our wives and our little ones will be carried off as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us just to return to Egypt? Whenever you lead, somebody's going to complain. Leadership, though, is all about influence. A coach, a teacher, a pastor, a parent. We don't need to hide under a bush and not deal with the facts, but we need to be as positive as we can. We need to give people some hope. Praise God. Grumbling, backbiting, and negativism will happen, but what are we going to do about it? They even went on to say in verse 4, they plotted among themselves, let's choose a new leader and go back to Egypt. They wanted to choose a new pastor. They didn't like Pastor Moses. They sang. All those who sang their country songs died off because they wandered 40 years in the wilderness. Nothing against country music. People, though, seriously, you mess up when you chase negativity. You're wasting your time. Well, I better talk to that person at the office. No, pray and stay above the fray. Stay at the task God has called you to do. Amen. Well, Mike, is there any hope for me to get rid of this negativity in life, this negative thinking? Yes! That's the good news. How can I get help from this infectious disease called negativity? Well, one, you get clean. The C is, I'm doing an acronym here. The C is, I'm saying get clean, and the C is for connect. Connect and come clean. We need to connect with some and come clean with others. Look at your relationships. Reevaluate them. There's all types of people you can run with. You can run with the energy sucker, I call. They just drain you and tell you how bad everything is about them, and they'll drain you. And we need to take compassion, but it doesn't need to be one-sided here. Neutral people, they make a deposit in you, but shortly after, they're going to make a withdrawal with some negative things. And then there are replenishing relationships. They fill you up. They say you can do it. They say it's okay, pick yourself up. They say it's going to be all right. God is still for you. You're still surviving. It may not look good, but God is for you. He's with you, and you can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. That's the kind of people I want to be around me. How about you? Amen. L stands for look and meditate upon the Lord. Look at what the Lord has done. How many of you can say that? Look at what the Lord has done. What He has done, what He is doing, and what He's going to do in my life today. The E stands for enjoy. We need to enjoy life and things. We need to be appreciative. We always, some people, including myself sometimes, we look for this grandiose utopia that if we can attain this or we could get this, yes, then we'll be happy. Be appreciative where you are. The simple things. And we sing a song, Jesus is the center of my joy. And one of those verses says, I'm paraphrasing here, but I'm so glad for the simple things in life. Like your family, your husband, your wife, your friends, your colleagues, even your dogs and your cats that you love so much. I'm serious. I mean, we go outside in the springtime, and I have several rabbit friends, and I look out in the morning, and they're chewing on the grass, and I'm getting kind of sad because I don't see them lately. I guess I don't know where they're gone. Somebody got them, I love seeing my little rabbit friends. Call that stupid. I wake up, look, Melanie, look, there he is. There he's chewing the grass again. Call me kid-like. I don't care. I'm going to enjoy myself. See, positive people, though, are appreciative. Negative, forever complaining. Don't ever have enough. I mean, the children of Israel, think about it. Delivered from slavery. Our ocean was parted for them. A GPS system to guide them through the day and night. Not enough. So I want to go on. A stands for action on the acronym CLEAN. I looked it up the other day, and this is from Harvard Business Review. So some very smart people that wrote this, okay? It takes 5 positive statements to negate every negative statement. That's why it only took 10 people to destroy 3 million. Negativity is, because it's natural, it's not supernatural. See, supernatural is what God says. Natural is what we say in our carnal mind. And it takes a lot of positive. Takes 5 positive statements to overcome every negative one. So when you're making your confession of faith, don't turn around, because you're going to need to make a lot of confessions of faith to overcome that negative. We all slip up, but guard yourself, amen? And believers, we can be positive in every situation. That needs to be a good amen on that one. And the N stands for navigate through negativity. You know what? It seems that when God, I believe sometimes He allows these things, when He wants to build more patience in me, He gives me an opportunity to be negative or to be patient, appreciative, and thankful. And sometimes we all fail. But we need to have that success rate high. Amen. God will sometimes put some of these people, they love you, they're good and meaning well, but around you to make you grow. They might put some people singing some sad country. He might put some people singing some sad country songs around you. But you got to overcome it. Navigate through it. Amen. The bottom line is life, even with 80 to 85 years on the average, life is way too short to be negative. Amen. How many of you agree? Now look, I was thinking about this, and I know more. Some of you may not know any of it, and I talked with her, and so today may not be, I'm just off the spot, But I think this is a good opportunity. I didn't even know they were coming. I knew at some point they were coming back. But see, the faith and positivity of God is what changes things. And I can't find any better opportunity. And I asked her, I said, when you come back, would you like to say something? Because, and she said, I would. And I don't want to put you on the spot, but Huberta, can you say, I think this will flow so well. If you don't, that's fine. But you want to say something, you don't have to be long.
Oh, come on up. Come on up. I think this will flow. Come on. Y'all come on. I can't find any better way to talk about something positive than this situation. To God be the glory, but I want them to tell you. Oh, and Jordan. Oh, man.
Yeah, he really put me on the spot. I wasn't prepared today. But I guess sometimes the best things are surprises, right? Not always planned. I don't know if there is a short version, but probably a lot of y'all don't really know what went on in our lives. It was just too emotional to even talk about it. Of course, Pastor Michael knew the morning of, because when we got back home, I asked, well, Charles said, do you want to call Pastor? And I said, I can't talk. I mean, I just cried. So he called Pastor Michael and gave him a little rundown. But over the course, we were in touch with Sister Melanie, Pastor Michael, and I was always telling him to relay the message to Bishop and Sister Lois. But basically, this is not, I say it's not Jordan's testimony, because one day he's going to be able to tell you his own testimony. This is his mother talking. I'm speaking about what I went through and my experience and how I know that there is a God. And these last days, he's going to be working more miracles than we can even imagine, because you're looking at one right now. When I got that phone call, you know, as a mother, we always have this fear when our kids are not with us that something will go wrong. I think that's just being a mother. Sister Lois, you can relate. You know, we always have that feeling. But anyway, it was probably about 2:30 in the morning when I received the phone call. And everybody that know me knows that I love to talk. And maybe that's a good quality, maybe a bad, I don't know. But anyway, that night I got a phone call about 2:30 in the morning. It was a number I didn't recognize. And so when I answered the phone, it was Jordan's friend, Trey, who has been to church with us many times. And he was very emotional. So, of course, I got out of bed because I said, oh, boy, I can hear Charles right now saying, what is she talking about now? So I got up easily and went in the kitchen because I felt like I needed to condole this kid. And so I'm sitting there drinking water talking. About 15 minutes in, he asked me, he says, Ma, have Jordan called you? I said, well, sweetie, it's 2:30 in the morning. There'd be no reason for Jordan to be calling me. He says, well, I can't reach him. I keep calling him on his cell phone, and he's not answering. So then it just kind of dawned on me. I says, Trey, was Jordan with you in the car accident? He said, yes, ma'am. I said, oh, well, was there others? He said, yes, there were two girls, too. So anyway, at that time, I said to him, have you called your mother? He said, yes, ma'am. She's on her way to Greenville. I said, okay, I got to go. I need to call Jordan. So I called his cell phone maybe 3 or 4 times, and I didn't get an answer. So I knew something was wrong, because Jordan knows I wouldn't call him that time of morning if there wasn't something going on, and he would answer. So anyway, the next step was to call. I didn't wake up Charles. I said, let me call Nash General. Call Nash General. You know, now you can't find out nothing. But the lady, she was so kind. I did tell her. He told me about where the accident was. And I told her, I said, ma'am, please, can you look in your system? This was a terrible wreck from what I understand. And then she put me on hold, came back and said there was a accident on Hunter Hill Road that involved 2 kids being transported by helicopter to Vidant and 1 by ambulance. So I hung up and I said, the math ain't adding up. There's 4 kids, but she only told me about 3. So then at that point, I knew, I said, I got to go wake Charles up. I said, something is wrong. I don't know if Jordan is alive or dead, because I know I was only counting three kids from what she told me. But I didn't lose my faith. I was believing I was going to find my son alive. And so I go in there and I said, Charles, we got to go. We got to go to Vidant in Greenville. It was a terrible wreck. I think he was in worse shape, believe it or not, than me at that time. Because if y'all know my husband, he lost a daughter to a tragic car accident. So on our way to the hospital, one of the things he said to me as we were driving, I was driving, he said, back when I lost my daughter, I prayed to God that I would never have to live through this feeling again of not knowing if your child is dead or alive. So anyway, that was the longest trip. Probably when we were maybe a few miles, the highway patrol finally calls me and tell me that my son is there. And I told him that I had already got word from the driver of the vehicle. We were almost in Greenville. I told him then to please give the doctors my information and have them call me. So it wasn't but a few minutes after that, the doctors called me and say, was I driving? I said, yes, ma'am. They said, are you by yourself? I said, no, my husband's with me. She said, well, I need you to pull over. So I knew then it was not going to be what I wanted to hear. So I pulled over, and she said that my son had just came out of surgery. He had experienced one of the worst TBIs that she'd ever seen. They had to remove the left side of his skull. He also, his brain was hemorrhaging, and also his right femur was broken to three pieces. So we knew it wasn't good. So I told her I was almost at the hospital. She said, well, because of COVID-19, you cannot see your son. I says, ma'am, you have to let me see my son. And so I begged her. She says, okay, we'll give you 10 minutes. You can come and see him for 10 minutes. So when we got there, we went through the emergency like she told us. And when we got there, they said, only one person can go. So then I said, oh, my God, are you kidding me? Charles can't go with me. And so Charles says, honey, you can do this. You go, because only one could go. And at that time, you got to understand, it didn't look good, you know, from what the doctors were saying. But we know better. But at that time, we knew it was bleak. So I walked that hall, and I got back there to see my baby. She had already prepared me for what I was to see. And I never took a picture of it, because when I saw my son, I said, Lord, I never want to see this again. Unfortunately, as a mother, it's programmed in your brain. You know, I didn't need a picture because I could still see that look that was on his face. When I got in, I said, I only have 10 minutes, so there's not going to be any crying. And I didn't. I said, all I can do is pray. And when I spoke to Jordan, and I don't know that Jordan at that time could hear me or not, but all I told my son was, Jordan, if you do hear me, I know you may can't say a lot of things right now, but all I need you to say, the young lady that just sung that song with Pastor Michael, I says, Jordan, all you have to do is just say, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. That's what I kept speaking over his body. Because at that time, I didn't even really know what to pray. Everything that was going on, I didn't know all his conditions. I just know it didn't look good. So anyway, I stayed in there over that time, and then I left out. And the days to come, you know, got even worse. They had, through the process, because like I said, they had to be cut out of the car. One of the young ladies passed that was in the back seat with my son. She didn't make it. That's why the numbers didn't add up. But anyway, She, over the days to come, let's see, they wouldn't let me stay in the hospital. So that was terrible within itself. You know, as mothers, you know, we kind of always been, when our child falls, we want to pick them up, kiss their little scrape, and we know they're going to feel better. I mean, that's just what mothers think. So they wouldn't let me stay to do that. So that was a knock. But you know what? Later, not necessarily right then, God showed me that it was a way for me to develop my faith. Okay, I had to believe that God not only can be at my house healing me with what I was to face, but he was also at Vidant Hospital at Greenville healing my son. But it took me a while to get there, because in the beginning, you don't understand. All I could say is, why me? You know, why me? We've already been through enough. Not, you know, I can't deal with anything else. But I got over that. I got over that, and I knew I had to. So probably after about 2 weeks, I could look at when I would be praying, and I would say to the devil, you know what? Why not me? And I don't mean that I wanted this to happen to me, but what I mean is, you know what? We're not giving up. And anybody that knows my son knows that Jordan has not always had life easy through school or whatever it may be. So he was a born fighter anyway. And heck, you know, I don't mind a good fight either. So I had to stop having that little pity party. But there were days that, you know, it would get me down because, like I said, the reports were not always good. They had a mistake and ruptured his windpipe when they intubated him before they airlifted him to Vidin, and so he was getting oxygen in his lung cavity, in his chest cavity. Then after that, he developed pneumonia, so he was having high spikes in his temperature, and throughout this whole process, Jordan was not conscious. He was unconscious for 21 days, so I couldn't speak to my son or see my son throughout that whole process. And I barely could get updates from the hospital, so it was really not the best situation, but we had to make it, you know, as good as we could. Finally, I took some pictures. This is when Jordan made his breakthrough. One of the PAs, who was awesome, I'll never forget his name, Bart, he called me one day and said, can you bring some pictures here? Because Jordan had got to where he would try to open his eyes, but he was still what they considered non-responsive. He wouldn't respond to any commands. He would do nothing but lay there, and then he would close his eyes back. So that was beginning to be troublesome to them. They pretty much had already told me multiple times that I needed to be looking for a nursing home for my son. And I said, I don't need to look for a nursing home because Jordan is coming home. You know, and at that point, it didn't matter what his condition was. I knew my son was coming home. That was all that mattered. I mean, I cried night after night. I said, but my son will come home, and whatever his needs are, Charles and I had already talked about it, we were going to be able to provide. But I was believing more than that. I said, you know, he's coming home as close to what he was before he ever went there. And so anyway, getting back to the story, I'm sorry, I'm all over the place. Like I said, I wasn't prepared today. But like I said, I took the pictures up there, and believe it or not, the next day when Jordan opened his eyes and he saw the pictures, and I just took immediate family because we knew that he probably wouldn't recognize a lot or be able to say anything because they thought his brain stem was damaged. So they didn't expect Jordan to ever speak again, talk again, walk again, that he was going to be pretty much in a vegetative state. That was pretty much where they were leaning toward. But anyway, sweet Jesus, when he saw his mother's picture, he said, Ma, the PA was so excited that he called me. And luckily, like I said, Charles was home, so he FaceTimed me, and I got to see my son. I mean, it was still, you know, with what he had gone through with the cranioplasty, you know, he didn't have a left skull. So it was Band-Aids, helmet, all of that kind of stuff. But anyway, when everybody knows me that I'm always excited about whatever. And so, of course, when I got to see him, I said, hey, Jordan, how you doing, baby? You know, I said, I'm so glad to get to see you. And that's when he said, Ma. And his next words were, I'll come home. That was his next words. And then so I talked some more, fighting back the tears because I was in pieces. At the end of our conversation, Jordan said to me, I love you. And so at that point, that was my confirmation. There was nothing wrong with my son because, number one, he knows who I am. Number two, he know he ain't home. Because he said, you want to come home. So I already knew, okay, now you're not going to tell me nothing's wrong with him. And then number three, I love you. Because that was something we always do. We say that when we leave each other. So I said, okay, that's all I need. Now, the rest, we're going to work on it, and we're going to get there, but I already know what the doctors told me is not accurate, okay? And I'm thankful for what they told us, because that's going to make Jordan's testimony even better one day, because we know what the doctor said, and we know what he is. So anyway, saying all that to say, finally, I did get into the hospital, praise God. Pastor talked today, the God we serve, he don't do bad things. And Jordan understands the car accident had nothing to do with Jesus Christ as far as the accident part, had the happening of the accident. The part that Jesus Christ played a part in is saving him. Okay, for whatever reason, he saved my son, because all the EMTs, all the doctors, everybody that we've spoken to since then said that they never would have believed that any of these children would have survived this accident. I mean, the car doesn't even look like a car. And he's a living, walking, you know, testimony. We stayed in rehab for over 3 weeks. He passed every test. They couldn't believe it. They would come in and just shake their head. They just didn't know what to say, because there was just no answers to why he could do what he was doing. He would come in with terrible migraines, and he would keep pushing every day, every day. And so we knew then, I said, Jordan, you're going to be okay. You know, it's going to take a while for you to do all the things you used to do. He had to learn to walk again. Even his speech now with aphasia is so much better than when he first started, because he could only do maybe 3 words in a sentence. Now if you get to talk to Jordan, he can say a lot of words. He's getting to be almost as much as his mother, which might be a good thing. But saying all of that to say, like Pastor was just saying, you could look at Jordan's situation in more ways than one. We could have looked at everything on the negative side, because no doubt Jordan has been changed. You don't be in a wreck to this magnitude and there's not some things that's going to be changed in your life. But the good thing about that is change ain't always bad. And we as Christians have to realize that. You know, sometimes things happen, so maybe we need to just slow down and smell. What's the old saying? We need to slow down and smell the roses. So sometimes, you know, when things happen to us, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be a bad ending. It just puts us on another track for a better ending. And that's the way I look at it. We remain positive. We're going to stay positive and stay focused. And I know Jordan may want to say just a few words. I don't want to deny him that if it ain't nothing but. And it's just so funny. I have to share this. We talked to Pastor Michael one time. And this was early on. We was in rehab at the time. And it was amazing because he recognized his voice. He knew Pastor Michael's voice. And he calls him Boss Man. And I talked to Pastor Michael later, and I said, Pastor Michael, it was no disrespect. But at that time, Jordan couldn't say pastor. That was one of the words he hadn't learned again. And so I said, Pastor Mike, no disrespect, but he may call you that. And even sometime now, because if you know a little bit about aphasia, he may say the wrong name or a word he can't find. But I told you all I could talk all day. But I will say this, throughout this whole process, the one word that Jordan never forgot, and every time I would ask him, he was always able to say, Jesus. I don't understand that one, but he could. Even on the days of the week, he wouldn't know the days of the week, but I would always say, Jordan, do you know what today is? And he would say, no. I said, today is Sunday. I says, what do you do on Sunday? Church. He said, you go to church. So it's just amazing at things like that that we take for granted, you know. He is a true miracle. A couple people would ask me, said, well, how did you all get him? Did you have to put a ramp at your house? I said, a ramp? For what? I said, my son walked in. I mean, like I said, God is so good. One day, like I said, Jordan will be able to tell his true testimony. I'm telling you from a mother's point of view, I guess, and what I went through. But one day he'll be able to tell you, you know, sometime now. He walks all the time now, and I don't know if it's because he couldn't walk for a while or what it is, but he walks. He's doing this all the time. Sometime we have that doorbell ringer. Charles has to just shut it off. He says, well, it's only been 1 hour, and Jordan set it off 30 times. I said, well, you know what, honey? Just cut it off. You don't need the alarm anyway. I said, because, you know, he's probably so thankful that he can walk that he just paces. I mean, he's going back and forth. But anyway, I mean, I think that's a good thing, you know, and everything is healing up. I do ask for prayer tomorrow. He has some hearing loss in his left ear. He has a CT scan tomorrow in Greenville, but we're believing that when they go in there and whatever they see or whatever, it's going to be nothing. He's healed. We know that. It's just in stages, but we already know that he is healed. There will be no more surgeries. You know, he's just going to continue to progress every single day. Is there anything, Jordan? You just want to say maybe thank you for prayers or whatever. Yes, you can. You can say thank you.
I just want to say, thank y'all. And that's it.
And I had to tell him before coming in today, no hugs, Jordan. Because everybody that knows Jordan knows that he will go to everybody. Doesn't matter if he know you or not, and he's going to give you a big hug. That is Jordan. I says, okay, Jordan, you understand. Just due to the fact that he did have internal things that was going on, too, and the pneumonia with his lungs, we had to be very careful. So it's not that he doesn't want a hug, but one day he'll be able to squeeze y'all so tight and give you lots of love. And we love y'all. Thank y'all.
Awesome. Praise the Lord. I know this has been a little longer than normal, but I just thought it flowed so well. Not planned at all, but the Holy Spirit can put things together. Amen. That is great. Praise the Lord. I just want to say thank you today for coming. Have a blessed day. Have a blessed week. And we will see you Wednesday night back here at Fellowship Church. God bless you all.